Welcome back to our lecture series 4220, Abstract Algebra 1 for students at Southern Utah University. As usual, I'll be your professor today, Dr. Andrew Misseldine. This is the first video in lecture 13, which is based upon section 4.2 from Judson's Abstract Algebra textbook about the multiplicative group of complex numbers. So in this lecture, what I want us to do is review the topics of complex algebra and use this to define a cyclic group that lives inside, well, actually families of cyclic groups that live inside the complex numbers. And so in order to do that, there is a necessary review of complex numbers, and I don't know necessarily how much a review you as a viewer are going to need. Because there are many places in the standard undergraduate curriculum where complex numbers come up. The most obvious one would be a course like complex variables, which by the end of that course, you should be quite affluent in the language of complex numbers. Personally, I use a lot of complex numbers when I teach a class like linear algebra, that's Math 2270 here at Southern Utah University. You might see trigonometry like in a calculus class, I should say, you might see complex numbers in like a calculus class, trigonometry, college algebra. And so if necessary, you're going to find some videos at the end of this lecture that will review the basic ideas of complex algebra. So the things that you do need to remember right now is that when you see the letter I, we're referring to the complex square root of negative one. There's no real number which squares to be negative one. So we invent a new number, which we call a complex number, in this case, imaginary number, that does exactly that. Complex numbers are the linear combinations of a real number plus an imaginary number. This first part's the real part. The second part's called the imaginary part. The thing you really should know about when it comes to complex algebra, adding and subtracting complex numbers is essentially just combining like terms. When it comes to multiplication, as you have every complex number is essentially two-dimensional. There's two terms there. When it comes to multiplying complex numbers, really just FOIL them out. What you really need to know is the following. When you have I to the zero, this is just equal to one, because any non-zero number raised to zero should be one. I to the first is itself. When you square I, well, because it's the square of negative one, this is equal to negative one. And when you get I cubed, as this will be I squared times I, you're gonna get a negative I. And then when you go to the next one, I to the fourth is going to give you one, because you get negative one squared, which is one. I to the fifth is equal to five. I to the sixth is equal to negative one. And I to the seventh is equal to negative I. And this pattern just kind of repeats itself over and over and over again. Powers of I can be computed just by reducing the exponent by four and considering the residue, that is the remainder when you're done with that, because every power of I will be one of these four numbers, one I, negative one, negative I. So for example, if you did like something like I to the 27th power, we can recognize that I, you'll have I to the 24th, which is a multiple of four times I cubed. Multiples of four, we can just ignore because those are just equal to one. And so this becomes I cubed, which is negative I. On the other hand, if you take like I to the 101 Dalmatian power there, well, that would break up as I to the 100 times I to the first. 100, of course, is a multiple of 4, 4 times 25, and so you just end up with I right here. So we can compute powers of I by using a reduction of the exponent mod 4. Complex division comes down to basically rationalizing the denominator. We multiply the top and bottom by the conjugate of the complex number. So a plus bi is equal to a minus bi, like so. And so we can then compute all of this complex arithmetic can be done now, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. I want to mention, though, that this anomaly we see about powers of I is kind of a curious thing. If we take the set of the four numbers you see right here, 1, negative 1, I, negative I, This together actually forms a subgroup of the multiplicative group of complex numbers, because notice one times anything will be that other thing. Negative one will just switch the signs. If you times I, if you square, you get negative one. If you cube, you get negative I. If you take the fourth power, you get one. This set right here is closed under multiplication. It has an identity. It has inverses. One's its own identity, or inverse, excuse me. Negative one's also its own inverse multiplicatively. And then I and negative I are the reciprocals of each other. This gives us a subgroup of order four inside of C star. And in fact, it's a cyclic subgroup. What we want to do in this lecture is essentially generalize this cyclic subgroup. It turns out these subgroups are quite ubiquitous in the complex field here, C star. And so now you should hopefully see some links on the screen. If you need some more practice with addition, subtraction of complex numbers, click the link to the top left. If you need some more practice with multiplication of complex numbers, please click the link to the top right. If you need some practice with division of complex numbers, click the link to the bottom left. And then finally, as it is, well, you know, if you feel okay with any of these things, then you can skip ahead to the next video about primitive roots, which is in the bottom right on the screen.